David, thank you also very much, CSC, for your kind of hospitality and welcome here today as well. My job in the next 20 minutes, 25 minutes or so is to give a very broad discussion about data requirements in the humanities, which you'll quickly spot as quite a diverse community and quite a challenging process to be able to put together into a 20-minute presentation. So what I thought I would do, first of all, is to start with some very general comments and then move towards some very specific examples. And I'm going to do this partly on the basis of some sketches of some recent work which I've been involved in, but also which my colleague Martin Donnelly has been involved in. So this is very much a double act between the two of us. And what I wanted to do is to start by sort of setting the scene really for us in the humanities, and doing that in quite a soft and friendly way, and then moving through that series of questions and answers towards trying to understand what research is like, trying to understand what research infrastructure therefore would be like, and therefore looking for some more specific recommendations, so coming towards some quite specific things. But I'm going to start with Walt Whitman. I'm going to start with a poem which seemed to me entirely appropriate for today. When I heard the learned astronomer, when the proofs, the figures, the charts and diagrams, when the proofs, the figures were ranged in columns before me, when I was shown the charts and diagrams to add, divide, and measure them, when I sitting heard the astronomer where he lectured with much applause in the lecture room, that's for you, David, how soon unaccountable I became tired and sick, till rising and gliding out, I wandered off by myself in the mystical, moist night air, and from time to time looked up in perfect silence at the stars. There's a really nice message, I think, embedded in this little poem, because let's not miss the point that a lot of the science infrastructure has come from astronomy. It's come from big science. But there's a nice commentary here on the nature, I think, of the humanities and the nature of understanding and knowledge as it's constructed in the humanities. So we start with a thanks to Walt Whitman for setting the scene for us. What he's touching on there is, if you like, something irreducible, something which cannot easily be articulated as, for example, numbers or columns or tables. Talking about the constitution, perhaps, of evidence, remember, it's the same stars that Walt Whitman is looking at as the learned astronomer. What is evidence like? What is data like in the humanities? And oftentimes you will quickly stumble across, anyone who's worked in the humanities will quickly stumble across this term data and find it in fact to be surprisingly problematic for the humanities to deal with. Humanities tend to talk about sources rather than data, and there is certainly a primacy of sources, and there's a hierarchy indeed of that source material, but to talk of sources is more useful than to talk of data, and there's a computing science conception of data, and there's a humanities conception of data, and they can sometimes bump into each other unhelpfully. Data or sources in the humanities tend to be partial. This is a little screenshot of the electronic Beowulf. Beowulf, the Anglo-Saxon poem, which tells us of Beowulf's struggles with the monster Grendel, and then Grendel's mother gets involved and it all kicks off. We only get Beowulf's version of the story. We don't get Grendel's mother's story of what happened. That's to say the source is partial, and that's characteristic of humanities sources. Sources are fragmentary. They have to be fragmentary. Vincenzo, for example, wouldn't have got here today because Italy would still be thick with Romans if the sources weren't fragmentary. So we very seldom get a complete comprehensive picture. They're often very specific. And sources in the humanities change. They can be tricky. A new source can emerge, or a new translation, or a new analysis can change the nature of the fundamental evidence. And that's where we can reinvent our analysis of, for example, the Beowulf manuscript, 12th century, and yet it's still the subject of active debate. It doesn't go out of use. I'm struck by that idea of the data being of no value after 2 or 3 years to the commercial sector, for example. You can see, in this case, at least 800 years worth of exploitation of the same source. In the humanities, interpolation is risky. So when we talk about Beowulf, we talk about, you know, one saga or one story in one place at time. And it can be very difficult to extrapolate from that to other times and places. And oftentimes our analyses are sui generis. So it's not sufficient to reduce one set of arguments to another set of arguments. And this has particularly been the case in the philosophy of religion, where it's been very fashionable to explain away religious phenomena through, for example, psychology or sociology or anthropological approaches. In actual fact, a phenomenological approach to the study of a topic like that would say that it has to be understood in its own terms and can't be passed off as something else. All of this is just a sort of slightly fluffy introduction to say that, therefore, when approaching topics, the humanities tend to be, well, yes, empirical, there's a fundamental evidential weight to arguments that are put together, but also interpretative and also hermeneutic. That's to say, not only is it sufficient simply to table the evidence, but that evidence needs to be understood. And we're likely to go over that interpretation over and over and over and over again in what might be called a hermeneutic kind of cycle. And to construct an argument in this context requires not just appeal to data, but also appeal to other characteristic approaches. So what's the efficiency of an argument? What's the consistency of an argument? What's the paradigm in which that an argument would be put together? So I'm going to play a little game with you now, and I hope you'll indulge me in this, and we can have some fun. I want to look at language as a container for meaning, and I'm going to suggest that language is a poor container for meaning and a poor container for understanding the world. And this is a very obscure point, but it comes out of really very substantial amount of research in linguistics, and it comes really, I suppose, most fashionably from the world of structural linguistics, where we talk about the difference between signifiers and the signified. Now, why am I taking you down this route? Well, let's think for a moment, and let's park for a moment thoughts about data sharing. Let's think for a moment about controlled vocabularies or ontologies and related tools which we use in data sharing. Let's think about what the implications would be for some of those tools in the context of how we make meaning. I'm going to give you, let's do this twice. The first one is going to be an opportunity for you to participate in this. So you'll need a pen and a bit of paper to play this game. I'm a fan of a game show in the UK called Catchphrase, where a picture gets shown on the screen and you have to say what you see as quickly. Some of you will know this. Some of you are looking at me very strangely now. What I need you to do is to say what you see. I'm going to put a picture on the screen and I need you to say what you see. And if that doesn't work, I'll use an example of my own from previous research to do with classification. But the point I'll make at the start is, in both cases, we're talking with real, substantial, material things. Think how more complicated this is going to become when we deal with airy-fairy concepts. So is everyone ready with pen and paper poised to say what they see? So here's a little picture of a fairly recognisable archaeological or heritage site, and I just want you to say what you see. Okay. Has anyone written anything down? Does anyone want to shout out what they say what you see? The Wailing Wall. The Wailing Wall, not the Great Wall of China, the Wailing Wall, or the Western Wall, or any number of other different names. Hakotel, if you're Hebrew, or in Arabic, Hayat al-Barak, this is where, this is the western retaining wall of the Second Temple in Jerusalem. It's constructed by Herod in the 1st century BC. It's also potentially the site of the Third Temple in Jerusalem, and that really will be the start of the Third World War, make no mistake. It's also, what you can see actually here is a big open plaza. That open plaza exists because in 1968 the Israelis demolished the Moroccan quarter of Jerusalem to provide access to the wall. So there's an awful lot of politics in this too. You could say this is limestone. You know, this is also just limestone. And also you can see beyond that the gardens associated with the Dome of the Rock and the Al-Aqsa Mosque. And if you're looking really closely, what you'll see is there's quite a crowd of people over on the right-hand side of the wall. Do you see that? And there's actually quite more dispersed population or people on the left-hand side of the picture. That's because most of this picture is the men's enclosure. The women's enclosure for the Western Wall is really very, very small. So there's a whole gender politics, if you like, associated with this picture too. Why am I doing this? I'm just trying to express to you the difficulty of, you know, saying what it is that's in front of you. It's a very substantial, very solid One of the blocks in the Western Wall weighs 570 tons. One of the blocks weighs 570 tons. This is a very substantial thing, and if we struggle to describe something as substantial as that, think again how difficult it might be in the context of more abstract constructions. So, data can be tricky when it comes to expressing meaning in the humanities, and taking things out of context can be problematic. Therefore, data sharing where a potential for it to be wrenched out of context is problematic. Let me give you another example, and this is now straightforward storytelling with me from my previous employment where I worked for the City of Glasgow Museum Service. Glasgow, as many of you will know, runs a very substantial museum service, very substantial museum collection, which in 1941 was inadvertently bombed. Glasgow was the subject of a blitz on the industrial quarters of the city, and the 1941 Kelvin Grove Museum in Glasgow was bombed, and specifically the ethnographic collection. The ethnographic galleries were destroyed in 1941. And this is a great little example because actually we have a really good account of how the ethnographic galleries were put back together. And of course, this was quite a patriotic endeavour to reinstate the gallery. So here's what they said they would do. We hold that renewal and restoration should be carried out under the same motives as restorers in other museums and galleries. This is really positive. This is the ethnographic collection, remember. And they're saying it's as high value as any of the best art anywhere in the world. So this is actually quite a progressive statement, because those of you who have worked in museums will know that there is definitely a hierarchy and art is at the top of it and ethnographic collections are somewhere below. So this sounds very positive, but fairly quickly the wheels come off. So we've restored it in the best traditions, and we have divided the cultural stages of primitive societies into three groups to enable even the more casual visitor to grasp the cultural stages of different continents. So we have the lower primitives, the Australians, and we have higher societies. And why am I telling you this? I'm telling you this is because when we collected this stuff, we also collected and retained some unfortunate notions about the world, and that forms part of the context of this particular museum collection. So what? Well, let's think about what this means for the humanities and then move on to some substantive comments about research. First of all, the result of that is it can take actually a surprising amount of effort to constitute a data set within the humanities, or constitute your evidence, to find and justify and construct an argument based on that. That's why, in my view, in discussing this with colleagues, that's why the monograph is still the popular method of communication, because, you know, it takes a long time to constitute your data sets. It can take, therefore, a long time for publication to cycle, and publication half-lives, that is to say the time it takes for a publication to receive half its total number of citations, publication half-lives in the humanities tend to be longer than publication half-lives in the sciences. And actually, oftentimes what we're talking about is intergenerational research, as well as research happening across geographical boundaries. What does this mean for us? What is needed in terms of research infrastructure? Well, what we're talking about, and this is, in a sense, very obvious stuff, dependable access to stable and verifiable primary sources is vital. And that access can be delivered in a variety of different ways, but thinking primarily in a digital context, but digitized collections, that means via data centers. It also means good cataloging. It also means access to physical resources, metadata and whatnot. But it also follows that access to secondary materials or supporting materials, because that's where the contextual information comes from, is also going to be very helpful. And that might as much be coming out of the email of the scholars involved in studying collections. It might be annotations. It might be alerts and whatnot too. What does this mean for research infrastructure? It means, or what would the implication be for the humanities? Sharing access to data means sharing access to a broad and very widely defined collections of material. Digitized sources, born digital sources, a range of different types of objects. And it also means that providing access to tools and services in this context. I want to talk about a couple of myths, if you like, within the humanities. And I think the primary myth that we need to explode is the concept of the lone scholar. There's an expectation that the humanities are individuals working very much on their own. And that's never, in fact, been the case. One of the things I like most about this fairly obscure little diagram is how old it is. This is a model of archaeological research from 1992. This is the vision for a single European research area, and it still holds true. This is from Henrik Jarl Hansen, who was then at the National Museum in Copenhagen. Humanities research has always been a team event, just not always described as such. But of course, in the digital age, geographically dispersed and numerically small groups, this was true of Vincenzo's presentation too, these geographically dispersed and numerically small groups are connected as never before, and that creates opportunities for us. Also, there's an expectation in the humanities that they will have social and, if you like, democratic impact above and beyond the research that they output. And very many of the digitization programs in the humanities have come with assumptions of social impact and the social good that will come from democratizing cultural heritage collections. Other myths which I won't go into, but there's also a myth that humanities have small amounts of data. This is not true, as anyone who's worked with the visual arts, the performing arts, or linguistics will know. It's certainly not true of archaeology, my own background. And also a myth that there's a limited need for tools. That's simply not the case either, but we can talk a bit more about that over coffee. I want to move on now into much more specific terms and give you four sketches from the humanities. These are really four examples of work that we've been involved in. We know, and we've already had reference, John's already given us some very good pointers, and there are some URLs at the end of this presentation which point towards some of the other research which we think is of interest and which we would encourage you to look at, such as Daria, but some of the other material we've heard mentioned too. We only have a small amount of time to talk about four specific examples. So I'm going to talk about virtual organisations. I'm going to give you two examples. We're going to talk about digitization in the humanities, and we're going to look at some research done on digitization. We're going to look at data management planning in the humanities, and we're going to hear about some tools developed for that. Excellent. So let's very quickly mention, we can't talk about arts and humanities data, I think, without thinking about the Arts and Humanities Data Service, which I was part of, set up in about 1996, to provide shared service provision for data creation and data access within the humanities, part of, or a subsidiary, I suppose, of the Research Council, certainly in its later days. The lesson from AHDS, and AHDS no longer functions as a service, although elements of it do continue. The lesson from AHDS is partly about the difficulty of sustaining a virtual organisation through time. And it's really encouraging to have heard, for example, discussion of infrastructure pointing to more than technology, pointing to policy, pointing to procedure, pointing to legal aspects, because that, I think, more than anything, is a lesson from our experience at AHDS. A second example of virtual organisation, just a little archaeological example of work that I was involved in some time ago. Archaeology used to be quite an insane little discipline within the UK, where fieldwork units would do their fieldwork research, print it out and post it to, for example, the local government archaeologist, where it would sit on a shelf, of course, waiting to be entered back into the computer, and then periodically printed out and sent off to the national agencies, where it would again sit on a shelf and wait to be typed into the national monuments record. I think you can all see efficiency savings that could be had here, but let me just also, before we get there, point out that each of these different agencies was also trying to promote that to a wider public. Obviously, we can, you know, can we fix it? Yes, we can. We can do better. So by simply taking out some of the manual processes, we can retain some of the validation that happens, but remove some of the drudgery. So we end up with a system which provides access to archaeological grey literature in a much more sensible way. And just last night, checking, there are now something like 7,500 reports available. That's an enormous number. The point of that is not only are we having better access to the Grey literature, but it also drives up an improvement in the quality of the literature, because those reports are now written for an audience. There's an expectation that they will be seen, and therefore there's a requirement for us to do our work better. I want to talk about digitisation, because that's a major theme within the humanities. I'm going to talk about some research which we undertook with Portico and with ULCC on the JISC digitisation programme. JISC has funded, as you know, many digitisation initiatives. From this particular programme will work 16 different digitisation programmes within the UK, all for research and teaching within higher education. And we asked people in these digitisation projects how long they thought their digital resources would be available for. And we got a range of answers back. I'm particularly keen on the last one here, which points to something even worse than the usual joke of 5 years or forever, whichever comes first. We ask people simple questions: where, when, how are they going to undertake long-term data management? And we came back with a number of sometimes quite straightforward conclusions. You know, a written preservation policy is going to help. Collection and content management procedures matter. That a digital preservation infrastructure is going to be a requirement, and we should plan for sustainability. But we also learned some more obscure or more subtle conclusions. For example, there are artifacts in the way the funders give out money. And actually, there's a rule, for example, in JISC that the funding for data sets means that data sets have to be available for a minimum of 5 years. University vice chancellors here, a maximum of 5 years. And therefore, there's an artifact, if you like, in the funding process, which creates or changes the risk profile at that point. The rest of it you can read for yourself. I'm going to hand on to Martin now, who's going to introduce a little bit of the research data management work within Edinburgh University, and then we'll have a few words to wrap up.
Kitos. Not just Edinburgh University, but the Digital Curation Centre, which I represent. I work at Edinburgh University, which is one of the three partners in the UK's Digital Curation Centre. And one of the things that the University of Edinburgh is doing at the moment is preparing two policies with four groups. These are institutional data management and data storage strategies and policies at the university. Now, where did I come into this? I was asked to go and talk to the humanities representative on the research data management working group, who had no concept of what a data management plan might involve, nor did he recognise what he held as being data. In interviewing, chatting with him, it was established that he had custody of a great deal of data which was stored in classic humanities style on an unnetworked old computer in old formats, which sat underneath his desk at his knees and at his home. And it became clear to me that several of his issues could be mitigated at the very least, or could have been mitigated, by the production of a data management plan in the early stages. So there is an issue with terminology that this particular scholar didn't recognise what he did as data. And indeed, were he to look for help, which scholars are often reluctant to do, he would not probably have searched for data management, he would have searched for something else. So we have a problem there in terms of reaching these people in terms of terminology. So if I broaden the view out a little bit, the UK research funders, data management planning is becoming increasingly popular across all of the domains in the UK, and the research funders are increasingly mandating it. In the UK, the Arts and Humanities Research Council is unique among the RCUK councils in that it doesn't require a data management or data sharing or data reuse plan. It has something called a technical appendix, which I think is kind of indicative of their approach to, I suppose, computers in much more general terms. So again, this similarly to the data issue is indicative of the wider terminological problem. However, in the social sciences, which is not a million miles away from the arts and humanities, the situation is more encouraging. The new Economic and Social Research Council policy, which comes into force in 2011, places an increased emphasis on data management planning. And indeed, as John noted this morning, in the US, the National Science Foundation will require these again from early 2011. So in order to assist with this, the Digital Curation Centre has produced a tool called DMP Online, Data Management Planning Online. Now, this tool helps to create, maintain, export, and hopefully one day share and make available data management plans. Version 2 of the tool, which is forthcoming, also enables funder discipline and institution-specific guidance. This is in response to the terminological issue, which is that we hear time and again that researchers want to receive guidance, want to hear the advice, they want to receive best practice in the language to which they're most familiar. So at the moment I'm working with psychologists in York as part of a JISC-funded project to produce psychology-specific guidance for the completion of data management plans in the hope that this will pave the way for other disciplines. And finally, the Blue Ribbon Task Force notes that preservation and data management are derived demands. Nobody actually wants to do digital preservation, but they want to have access to their stuff in the future. So in order to be inclusive and to reach common ground, my view is that perhaps we need to take a step back from data management and consider things as access and reuse plans or something similar. So we're going to overrun a little bit, so antique C for that. But I'll pass back to William to conclude.
Just want to end with, I suppose, some bland conclusions, some things that you'll probably already have thought of by the time we get to this point. So the humanities are distinctive in respect of data, and Martin has emphasised that too in the context of the data management planning. But that doesn't mean to say they're not ready and eager and in need of research infrastructure or infrastructure to support their research. Dependable and timely access to reliable resources is the key. And connecting scholars and connecting resources and connecting scholars to resources adds value to both. And I do genuinely believe the humanities have experience that brings added value to this research infrastructure. So there are things to be learned in that context too. Anyway, I've said enough, taken enough of your time. Thank you very much. Didn't overrun too much, did we?
There is time for questions. I think we'll eat a little bit into lunch, but we have some time. So, questions for Martin and William?
Well, I mean, specifically what to do with the AHDS data sets, is that what you have in mind, Keith?
Yeah, how to look after them. I mean, it's a valuable collection.
Yes. Well, first of all, AHDS was itself, as you know, a sort of setup of 5 different agencies. So some of those data sets don't create specific concerns. So, for example, the Archaeology Data Service continues as previously unchanged. So my little section of that, I'll walk away from the rest of it. But that, so there is that data set. So there are successor services in place. The same is true of what used to be the History Data Service. Actually, was always part of the UK Data Archive, and in effect has been brought back in house at the UK Data Archive. More problematic, the Visual Arts Data Centre, Performing Arts Data Centres in particular. The Oxford Text Archive again had a previous history. I couldn't say I know for sure what the long-term plans were there, but I would defer to people from Oxford if there's anyone in the room who knows that. But I mean, there's not a straightforward answer. It's fair to say the Performing Arts Data Service, I think, had relatively small data sets in comparison to the others. But nonetheless, a promise and an undertaking has been made to depositors that those data sets will be collected and curated and managed through time. In theory, it would fall back to the host institution. It would fall back to either King's College London or the University of Glasgow, in the case of performing arts, for them to make continued access to those data sets. I look round for colleagues from Glasgow University who might know the exact state, or King's College London, who might know the exact state. Certainly, King's maintains access to these resources, but I think it does it on more or less a pro bono basis. It doesn't do it with any substantial amount of money in the background, and that is really a long-term risk, you know. And I suppose, in their defence, the AHDS probably didn't see this coming, although they probably... I mean, it was always a question that was asked of us, what would happen when AHDS goes or funding is wound up and it would be transferred to some other host agency or at least maintained by the, you know, King's and Glasgow and the host institutions.
And the general point I was making, I hope, was what is an acceptable business model for digital preservation?
Yeah.
And how important are mandates?
Yeah, yeah. Well, Martin mentioned the Blue Ribbon Task Force in this context, and that's a very important document, and we should have mentioned it perhaps more, this idea of preservation as a derived demand, and people want access to stuff, but they won't necessarily want to pay for preservation. So for me, digital preservation becomes part of, actually, in a strange way, it becomes part of something else. So digital preservation, in a strange way, is actually about, you know, customer service or other types of, and it's easy to justify why you would want customer service, or that's a very commercial example, but you know what I mean. And therefore, the costs for long-term access are actually about, you know, a subset of that are the costs for preservation. And the business case presumably comes from economies of scale. By having better access to this collection, we're able to do more. We're able to do things better or more cleverly. And part of my concern, actually, over the last few years has been realising that digital preservation is still seen as a problem. Actually, digital preservation is a capability. It's something we can do. And it's not, we should stop thinking, we should stop presenting it to people as a problem. We should start telling people, look, here's something you can do. Here's something that we have solutions for. Here's something, not only will it, do we have solutions for, it's going to bring advantage to you. So instead of thinking of digital preservation about risk management, let's stop thinking about planning out the risks. Let's start planning in the benefits. And in that context, the business case will be made much, much more effectively. Is that too bland? And maybe we can do this over coffee.
I ought to confess I'm on the board of JISC, and I was in RC UK, so I know the big problem handing over, and it really is a tricky issue of long-term sustainability. But I just want to take issue with you when you say humanities is different. I think in terms of looking at the global grand challenges, which I was talking about, it isn't different, actually. And what I was talking about, the training of people, I mean, for me, it's dead easy to do data analysis on electron diffraction or X-ray diffraction. It's when you get into all these other areas, which are less tangible, policy and all the rest of it. So I think we have a common aim there to train people. So, yeah. I mean, I've had long discussions with David Robey in the UK on this, and I think we are of one mind that we do need this all in inclusive training. Yes. So I would advise you perhaps be a little bit careful and say humanities is different. The individual disciplines may be, but when we join them all up, it's the same.
Yeah, you're quite right to correct me on that, John. And what I should say is that humanities are diverse, but that doesn't mean to say they're different from everything else. And you're absolutely right. The training needs are, in a sense, even more, I think, pronounced in some parts of the humanities. But the need for that training, a need for that policy framework is exactly the same. And it's good that they're aligned in that way.
One more question, and then I think we'll stop. As long as it's a short answer.
Yeah, I'll do my best.
Thank you. Maybe I would like to just comment, I try to be short, on your assumption that humanities are different from natural sciences. For example, you said something like the data are not cast in stone, and their understanding is not cast in stone, even in natural sciences. For example, the colleagues from ESA just show at the surface of the oceans. And we have just begun to have infrastructure to look into the first 1,000 meters of the oceans. Beyond that, there be dragons.
yes.
You know that one. Yes. And the other point is, we have some data sets from 100 years back.
Yes.
And we looked into it and saw, well, people calculated where they were to see where their measurements came from. And today we can see they didn't calculate correctly from their astronomical positions. We can easily see from their drawings that they were somewhere different.
Yes.
So maybe we, people doing infrastructure for natural sciences, should learn from your examples that there might be ambiguity, and this cannot be resolved by exact metadata or something like that. We maybe need some more context as well.
Yes. No, that's a fair point. I mean, I don't want to overestimate. I've overstated it. I certainly don't think the humanities are that different. I think there's a distinctiveness about how arguments are formed, I would guess. But it's certainly the case that, you know, there's an awful lot in the natural sciences which the humanities have in common. Or the natural sciences and humanities have in common. Some of these collections, you know, some of the best environmental or historical environmental, paleo-environmental stuff comes from, for example, ships' logs and whatnot, which are all really interesting archival sources and present the same interest or the same problems in terms of their manipulation and access across the humanities or the natural sciences, for example. Okay, thank you very much.